Well, it's time to hand over now to my anchor colleague, Christopher Springate, who's been working on a very big topic that's going to play a central role at this Global Media Forum. He'll be guiding you through the next segment, starting with that age-old question, when it bleeds, it leads. Christopher, it's an incredible claim. When it bleeds, it leads. Difficult for many of us. It seems it's bleeding more now than ever before. Is that claim still justified?
Well, I think it is. I mean, this is what we're going to be discussing with my panelists, which I'll be introducing in a short while. I think it probably is still valid as long as our coverage is balanced, as long as our coverage is accurate, and particularly important, as long as our coverage is representative of reality. There are many realities in this room, and we want to try and represent as many of them as possible.
Okay, we're going to have you back on stage in just a second.
Okay.
And to talk more about that. After all of the excitement, after all of the speeches, let's get a little bit more music. With Peter Matana now and Michelle Huppel, we're going to have some music now, a new number. It's called Herbst in English Fall. So let's take a little break after all the excitement with this musical interlude from these two gentlemen. Let's give them a big hand. Welcome.
Thank you.
Many thanks to Peter Materna and Michelle Heupel for that wonderful piece, Herbst or Fall. Thank you very much. Let's get Christopher back up here. A little teaser before we went to the music about the next item on our agenda today. We were just talking about if it bleeds, it leads, a difficult question for many journalists. And you were saying, Peter, Christopher, if it's well covered, if the coverage is good, then it's okay to go with it. Is that a way to put pressure on policymakers, perhaps?
Yes, it is a way of putting pressure on policymakers when we cover the difficult stories, the stories that are full of conflict, that are divisive. I think it probably is also, you know, justified. That is one of our roles as journalists. I'm sure there are lots of journalists in the room here today who will agree with me. We are watchdogs. We need to hold our politicians to account. I hope you'll excuse that little aside. But, you know, Brian, I think, you know, we've been talking about if it bleeds, if it leads. Yes, we are a voyeuristic species. You know, we if something is bleeding, we want to see what it is, and that is why it so often leads in our newscasts. But I think we are also a species that likes harmony, that, you know, empathizes with people that we see who are suffering. We want solutions. So one of the questions I will be asking of our panelists and of everybody here is, what can we do as journalists to support the search for solutions, to help our politicians find the right solutions?
That sounds like
solutions.
A positive direction. Take it away, Christopher.
Okay, thank you. Well, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Media Summit, the first debating event here at the Global Media Forum. We start the summit with a special moment, a keynote address from a man who used to pull the strings in Baden-Württemberg. He was state premier for many years in Baden-Württemberg. He now pulls many strings in Brussels, the EU's Commissioner for Digital Economy and Society. Please give a big hand to Günther Oettinger.
Dear Director General Peter Limburg, dear representatives of the German government, Professor Kütters and Professor Böhmer, dear Secretary of State Dr. Oettinger, dear Dr. Kofler, ladies and gentlemen, it's my pleasure to be here, representing the European Commission and seeing how impressive your 2 days conference is, a global network, a network of competence. And so I wish you and I wish your organizer, Deutsche Welle, to this 2015 Global Media Forum all the best and all the success you need. Ladies and gentlemen, the rise of digital has completely remodeled the media sector. Media convergence is a reality. The boundaries between traditional media and digital media are ever more blurred. For example, social media are hosting more and more professionally made content and are an increasingly important route to news. Take the discover feature of the instant messenger Snapchat, housing content from both broadcasters and publishers. Or the recent agreement between Facebook and some publishers, allowing them to offer their content directly on the platform and sharing or letting them manage advertising revenues. The Reuters Institute for the Study of Journalism, just published these days, shows that in countries like France, Germany, UK, Italy, and Spain, Facebook is increasingly the vehicle to deliver news. The same report also shows that a significant proportion of young people no longer wait to watch the evening television news. They prefer to find out what is going on as it happens from multiple sources of online media sources. Messaging services are also increasingly prominent. One quarter of Spanish internet users said they have read, watched, or discussed news on WhatsApp. Traditional and new media are quickly converging into a larger, predominantly digital media environment. physical boundaries, including among national media markets, are becoming less relevant thanks, for instance, of mobile technologies. The good news is that Europe has a very strong and high-quality media sector. In such a mutualable context, we only need to make sure that media are up to speed as regards innovation and that our regulatory framework is adapted to the new environment. I will therefore focus my intervention on three main aspects. Firstly, I intend to share with you some thoughts about the implications of media convergence for media businesses. Secondly, I will present the work the Commission has undertaken towards a regulatory modernization for the digital single market, including for audiovisual media services. And finally, I'll say a few words about the importance of preserving media freedom and pluralism. Ladies and gentlemen, new players join the market. New hybrid services become ever more popular, and a huge quantity of audiovisual content is available. This can bring new ways of monetizing content, new sources of advertising revenue, and new possibilities to reach out to consumers directly and through innovative methods. New market niches and opportunities for international development become available. There are also challenges. Established models and practices might have to be reassessed, and some players are struggling more than others to adapt. One of the challenges is to keep up to speed as regards innovation. I refer in particular to the necessity of investing more in research and technology innovation. I'm aware that investing in technology can be a challenge for the European media sector, especially in times of economic difficulties. The Commission is doing its part to help. We are funding research and innovation on social media verification, on convergence of traditional media services and internet-based services, and on the use of big data for media. In a few months, for example, we will publish the results of several research projects in the field media and content convergence. Only for these projects, we have spent 19 billion euros. But innovation is not just about technology. Business models need to be innovative too. I see encouraging examples of promoting an innovative mindset by European media companies. Take the German publisher Axel Springer. He has created its own media startups incubator. It's an initiative that other media companies could and should replicate. I also see media businesses, big and small, addressing the changing needs of the consumers in innovative ways. For example, Berlin-based startup LaterPay is a platform that enables content providers to sell digital content without having to register or pay in advance. This has the potential to simplify micropayment for all sorts of content on the internet. Designing content in a way that combines our strong cultural traditions with a global business mindset is also crucial. And our content productions are often of great quality. Yet, despite all this, I sometimes fear a certain risk-averse approach from the European media sector. I sense that far too many players are far too happy with their often regional-based or national-based comfort zone and lack an international perspective. I take the point that it's also partly due to the regulatory frameworks and to insufficient access to finance. Still, I believe there is scope for the industry to make further efforts. Ladies and gentlemen, the digital single market strategy that the Commission unveiled last month will lead to a more integrated EU market with better services at better prices and more choice. In monetary terms, bringing down digital barriers within Europe could contribute to an additional 410 billion euro to our European GDP. Our strategy revolves around three main pillars: improving access to online goods and services across Europe, digital networks and innovative services, and maximizing the growth potential of our digital economy, coming to a functioning digital union. On 1st of June in Berlin, German Chancellor Merkel, French President Hollande, and my President Juncker met to express their commitment to make the digital single market strategy a reality. And in a few days, a time, Thursday and Friday this week, our European Union heads of state and government will deliver their guidance on the way forward. This digital single market announces in our strategy two legislative initiatives that will have a direct impact on the European media and content landscape. First initiative, evaluation and modernization of the Audiovisual Media Services Directive. Regulation in this domain has a significant impact on the EU's economy and on citizens' everyday life. The EU Digital Single Market Strategy announces the creation of a media framework of the 21st century. With this goal in mind, the Commission is now assessing the functioning of the Audiovisual Media Services Directive, and this process is called REFIT. We are evaluating, and afterwards, this process will be followed by a proposal for the modernization of the directive mid in 2016. My vision is that businesses should be empowered to innovate and compete in the digital world. Our European creativity and rich cultural diversity should be promoted just as much as EU values and consumer protection. This directive has fostered unhindered cross-border transmission of audiovisual media services within Europe. Just consider that at the end 2013, about 25% of TV channels established in the EU targeted foreign markets, either European Union or extra-European Union. We want to offer to all stakeholders the opportunity to genuinely contribute to the modernization of the law. A public consultation will be launched in the coming weeks. I strongly encourage all of you to participate. Let me anticipate some of the main items the Commission is looking at. The current law applies to television broadcasts. It also applies to audiovisual media services offered online when the provider has control over the content. Services like Netflix are therefore already regulated by the directive. We will now assess whether other types of online services not regulated in this directive should be also regulated for to come to a fair competition, for to come to a level playing field between all of them. If we conclude in this direction, we will need to analyze what is the right legislative or non-legislative instrument to deal with this. This debate is important. We need to be sure that our regulatory environment is fair and fit for purpose in the digital age. Although the existing law applies a set of important societal values, rules to all audiovisual media services, but offers lighter touch regulation to the on-demand services where the users decide on the content and the time of the viewing. We will look closely at whether the system is working well, and if not, what are the right tools to address any shortcomings. For example, on commercial communications, such as advertising and product placement, we should consider the advent of new advertising techniques. Space for innovation in this field is important in the digital age. On the protection of minors, I already mentioned publicly that an assessment of existing rules is important. On the promotion of European works, the digital market strategy makes an implicit reference to the need to find most efficient way to promote European works, not only by broadcasters, but also in video on demand. Again, I'm looking forward to engage with you all in the weeks to come. And our second initiative is copyright reform. Copyright is another key domain which will be subject to modernization. A legislative proposal will be presented by the end of this year. In this area, I want to make sure that we find a good balance between the interest of the consumer, the user, the net community, and the creative sector, especially for the film industry and for the sports sector. For this reason, we are looking closely at ways consumers can access online services they have paid in another EU country, then they are on holidays, and at how we can achieve harmonized copyright exceptions in fields such as research and as education. We aim to modernize cross-border enforcement of copyright, and we intend to obtain a clear picture on how copyright-protected works are used by online intermediaries. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to conclude by mentioning a crucial value for the EU: media freedom and pluralism. Whether a media outlet is so-called traditional or online, media practitioners will always have to be warranted the right to report facts and offer their views and opinions. Political pressure, economic hardship, physical attacks against journalists, restrictive legislation, and a general financial crisis in the sector all influence the media's ability to operate freely. A lack of media freedom and pluralism affects negatively the European media and creative industries. This can indeed have an impact on a media company's decision whether to have a presence or to make additional invests in a given member state. Europe is unfortunately not immune to these problems. We should all react with our competences to these types of attacks to media freedom. I would like to inform you about the launching of two new independent projects in the field of media freedom and pluralism. They are part of the European Center for Press and Media Freedom and have the support of our European Parliament. These two projects, one coordinated by the Leipzig Media Foundation and the other one by Index on Censorship, will address media freedom violations in the EU and neighboring countries. Violations of press freedom will be observed, researched, registered, and reported to both the public and the relevant authorities. Actions to support threatened journalists will also be organized. The existing monitoring tools will be enhanced and complemented by digital training and campaigning actions. Our media pluralism monitor tool is another EU-financed pilot project. It is one independently by the European University Institute in Florence and their Center for Media Pluralism and Media Freedom to identify potential risks to media pluralism in our 28 member states. The first phase of the project, based on a sample of 9 member states, has showed that risks to media pluralism are spread all over the EU. The tool is currently being applied to the remaining member states. Ladies and gentlemen, I've mentioned media innovation, the modernization of regulation, and media freedom and pluralism as some of the key issues that the converging media environment is confronted with. In all of these areas, there is work ahead for every one of us. Media investors, NGOs, national authorities, European institutions, and citizens. I believe that such dialogue and coordinated actions at all levels can be effective to reinforce Europe's free and innovative media sector. Thank you all. I wish you a fruitful conference. All the best for your engagement.
The thoughts, ladies and gentlemen, of Günther Oettinger, the EU's Commissioner for Digital Economy and Society. And I think we can say thank you for his reiteration of Europe's commitment to media freedom and pluralism. Ladies and gentlemen, if it bleeds, it leads. Foreign policy and international crisis reporting, that is now the issue at hand. You can see the for my panelists, some of the chairs and tables are being put together. Let me just point to this young gentleman over there. His name is Yakov Leon, and you see he has his laptop open. He is reading your tweets. The hashtag is hashtag DW, it's up there on the screen, DW space GMF. So do make your comments. I'll be bringing in Yakov later during the debate to hear some of your comments. You can also put questions to us using that. There'll also, of course, be the option of asking questions directly. We'll be bringing microphone to you, or several. Let me just set the frame again for this debate. I made four assumptions, and I posed a question. We are a voyeuristic species, so if it bleeds, we want to see it, what's going on, which is why it leads. That is probably justified, I said, as long as our coverage is balanced, accurate, and representative of reality. The pressure that that puts on our politicians, who unfortunately won't be staying with us, is also, in my view, justified. But we also like harmony. We want solutions. And the question that I put is, what can we as journalists do to assist the search for those solutions? Should we be assisting that search? So lots of assumptions there, and I do, I'm sure that my panelists will challenge me on some of those assumptions, and I also appeal to you all to challenge those assumptions. We're going to spend the next 90 minutes discussing all of that, and to help me do that, I'm going to introduce our panelists. We have with us Katrin Sandmann. Please come up and take your chair. Katrin Sandmann is a very well-known German TV journalist, incredibly experienced. She's just come back from 5 weeks in Iran. She's covered crises and conflicts in Kosovo, in Iraq, of course, is one of the few German reporters to cover the Iraq war from Baghdad, one of the first international reporters at Hurricane Katrina. Please give a hand to Katrin Sandmann. We have with us also Richard Porter, who is one of the most senior BBC managers. He's the editorial and digital director of BBC Global News, which means he has a hell of a lot of responsibility. And nice to meet you. And he has had 10 years of experience already, more than 10 years of experience in senior BBC positions, including leading the BBC's coverage of the 9/11 attacks on the Twin Towers on the US in 2001. Big hand for Richard. Yeah. Now, we should have Annika Nyberg Frankenhaeuser of the EBU, but I have to confess we've been trying to locate her. There she is. Annika, good to see you. She is the media director at the EBU, the European Broadcasting Union, looks back on a long career for the Finnish state broadcaster YLE. Nice to see you, Annika.
Nice to be here.
And has a long career behind her as a radio and a TV reporter, also in management. Among other things, head of TV and news and current affairs at YLE. Big hand for Annika, please. Sitting over here and joining us in a matter of seconds, Andreas Zumach, a huge name in German journalism. He is based in Geneva, a newspaper correspondent there for the Tageszeitung. Yes, Andreas Zumach, one of my favorite journalists, if I might say so. Nice to see you, Andreas. The go-to correspondent on affairs of the United Nations, has written a couple of books on it, and was also one of the most vocal critics in this country of the Iraq War. Andreas Zumach. Last but not least, DW's very own Max Hofmann. Max is currently the head of our bureau in Brussels, which means he's facing a very busy day today, but he's taken time out to come and talk to us, which we're very grateful for. Max, before he was in Brussels, was our senior correspondent in Washington for 4 years. He's had already a, though he's only 41 years, he's had a long career already at
40,
DW.
Come on.
40? Sorry. Fact checking. He's been a reporter with us, he's been a presenter with us, he's been in management with us, yes, he's taken time out from a heavy schedule in Brussels to be with us today. Max. Max Hofmann. Please, do take your seats. I think we all have some water. Your microphones are there. Ladies and gentlemen, let's get straight into it. If it bleeds, it leads. Is that still, and I'm looking at you, Richard, is that still the best way of selecting international news? If it bleeds, it leads.
My phone's ringing.
Richard's phone is ringing. I did tell you he's very senior at BBC, so...
sorry.
No, if it bleeds, it leads. Is that still a valid way or the best way of selecting international news?
Well, it's a very simplified way of describing the issue for what is a very complicated, increasingly complicated world. So I kind of think the short, if you want a simple short answer to a very simple question, it's no. But maybe I should expand upon that a bit. I do think that, I mean, of course there is, you know, there's always been truth in the line, and when you simplify things in that way, it's always based on some element of truth. But I don't think that, I don't think it's anything like as simple as that. I think that that, for me, implies somehow or other that what we do is simply about ratings, about that that is above everything, that the first thing we must do is get the greatest number of people to watch and a greater number of people than somebody else. And I don't actually think that's the motivation, certainly not the motivation for what we do in the BBC. But as I say, we are an increasingly complicated world, complicated because of the stories we cover, big, globalized stories where it seems that every big issue stretches way beyond the borders of the story itself, where it starts from, and I think that poses a challenge for us. Complicated by all the things we've heard about so far this morning in terms of the way that the media is changing, that the fact that the audience is as capable of producing news as all of the media organizations themselves. And I think we are also in an era of contradictions, actually, of, as we've already heard this morning, more media than ever before, but not always more freedom. That's a very big contradiction that we face. We have bigger audiences than we've ever had before, and yet we have more financial pressures than we've ever had before. And we have, as I've said, the ability for everybody to produce their own news in their pocket, in their smartphones. And yet it's harder than ever to discern the truth, what you can rely upon. So when I think about these sorts of issues, trying to understand what the question might mean and what we should be discussing, those are the things that I come back to. And just to finish with what I think the BBC treats as a response to that, I think we go back to the fundamentals, as in doing our best to tell the truth, to be as accurate as we can be, to provide reliable services. Again, things we've heard a great deal about already this morning, and that's very much what motivates us. And I also think it's what enables you to continue to be successful, because as much as there is so much news, information, content out there, I think it is valuable for audiences to have places that they can go to that they trust and rely upon. And I think that's what the BBC very much builds the foundations of its journalism upon, has done for a very long time, and will continue to do so. So I think that's I've given you a long and complicated answer to a very simple question, but let's hope we can have some good discussions about it this morning.
And you've been trumpeting the BBC a little bit, just a
well,
little
I'll
bit.
Well, I'll continue to do that as well, if I'm given the
that's
chance.
Valid. But, that's valid. That's yeah. valid. Richard, so in other words, if it bleeds, it leads, still valid, but one of many criteria is what I get out of that in a very complex world. I'd like to bring in Annika. What is it... What are the decision-making structures at the EBU? Do you lead on the bleeding?
Well, we represent organizations like the BBC and Deutsche Welle. We represent 74 media organizations, mainly public service, across 56 countries. So it covers quite a large proportion of the media organizations that affect Europe. We don't choose the stories ourselves. They're chosen by the organizations that we represent. So yes, there is an editorial choice and there is an editorial part of what we are doing in the EBU, but we are not producing mainly for the public.
But you do see the choosing that other people are doing.
What do they use to guide that choosing? We do every day. And I my simple answer to this question would also be exactly the same as the BBC's. No, it's not if it leads, it bleeds. Or if it bleeds, it leads. And I don't think that's the biggest challenge to us either. I think the biggest challenge at the moment is the truth, because it's being challenged all over the place. It's being challenged by propaganda. It's being challenged by the fantastic thing that anybody can produce news, which I think is, from a democratic point of view, exactly the way it should be. But it certainly challenges... getting the truth out there, which is what I think is mainly a public service media value, and which is really at the core of what we are doing. Mm-hmm. So, should we be out there with the most sensational stories always? No, not necessarily. I think I would be very happy if the member organizations of the EBU would really look at themselves and go to the values and try to bring rather the truth and try to bring also those stories that are not the most sort of, you know, the top of the day. We all know that when there is a top story, that will always lead, that will always be everywhere, you will find it everywhere. But we also know that there's so much more than the top stories. And I really think it's one of our sort of obligations to bring that stuff to people.
And I know you want to talk about the challenges to the truth, and we had... Germany's Culture Minister Monika Grütters talking about massive Russian disinformation. So we will get to that.
I come from Finland, so I feel it very close, you know.
You have 1,300 kilometers of border with Russia. Indeed. We've just been covering that on our European Affairs program. Let me ask Katrin at this point. You're often where it's bleeding. Does that mean you have no problems getting your stories at the top of the news? And do you think that's right?
Well, I think sometimes it is right, sometimes it's not. So I would say yes and no to this, you know, sentence, when it bleeds, it leads. If you take the conflicts, today's conflicts, that's the best example you could give. I mean, there's a lot of coverage of, you know, the crisis in Ukraine, for example, whereas, you know, some of the conflicts are becoming so dangerous and so bloody that there is no more coverage at all. And that might not just be an editorial decision. Mm-hmm. I would say, you know, that's, you know, something that is the result of the fact that the world is becoming more and more complicated. And, you know, if you ask me, it's becoming more and more dangerous. So, yes, some conflict stories, some, you know, tragic events, some natural disasters, you know, would always lead the news if they happen, or in most of the parts of the world. When it comes to armed conflict, we didn't have reporters in Mosul, not only the German media, I think most of the world media didn't have reporters in Mosul or places like Raqqa. We don't really know what's going on, you know, in this Islamic State, in the so-called Islamic State. We don't actually know what, you know, the people of Daesh are thinking and, you know, why people would be joining them. All these are unanswered questions, I mean, and there's certainly no doubt that the conflict in Syria is a very, very bloody one, and it doesn't really get coverage.
Perhaps you can share with us a little bit, how did you decide to go to Baghdad to cover the Iraq war from there, for instance?
Well, I mean, the Iraq war was a long time. You saw it coming for a long time. So, you know, all of the news media would, you know, try and get visas for Baghdad. I mean, the question or the difficulty is always access, you know, how do you get in? How can you stay in? How not to be kicked out, which is something that happened. And, you know, there was a lot of arguing going on prior to the Iraq war in the different countries. You know, me as a representative of the German news media, or government at that time had a very strong stand against the Iraq war from the beginning. That was basically based on public opinion, I would say. So we all felt, you know, it was, you know, a duty or obligation to go there and cover the events, and then not only for the time of war, but especially for the time after the war to see, you know, whether or not this decision was right or wrong.
Okay, thank you for that, Katrin. Let me bring in Andreas at this point. Katrin, you're sort of a contrast in a sense to Katrin. Katrin's been sort of at the sharp end of many conflicts. You're at the diplomatic end in Geneva or in New York, where the UN is discussing these issues. Do you find that if it bleeds, it leads, gets in the way of what you're trying to inform us about?
Yes, it more and more often does, and I want a little bit take on Richard's first remarks, because I think he painted a too positive picture, which might be true for the BBC, or at least for some programs of the BBC, but it's not true for the whole global media reality. I think we do have a rat race, which is a rat race among competing media, especially the electronic media, to a lesser degree the print media. And the issue is who is first with the most spectacular news, and the most spectacular news are mostly violent conflict, blood, etc. And that makes it much more difficult for journalists to cover the very, very dreadful often efforts to maybe de-escalate or even solve a conflict on a diplomatic level to get into the news. I think the rat race is not, unfortunately, about who delivers the best analysis, the best in-depth information, and the best enlightenment for the people. And by doing that, and this is not a new question, Nick Going is among us. I remember covering the Yugoslav conflict more than 20 years ago, both in Geneva at the United Nations EU conference trying to solve it, but also in the field. And Nick Going, he coined the phrase of the dictatorship or the tyranny of the modern online communication technologies, which do not allow us journalists any longer to do the necessary research and investigation to get the story right. And by doing that, I think there are more and more examples where we all together miss the reality. And one of the most striking examples for me was the reporting about the Egyptian Arab Spring. For 3 weeks in a row, we had every night impressive pictures from the Tahrir Square in Cairo with 300,000 people demonstrating and some young Egyptians being able in perfect English to explain to us in 10 sentences about what it was all about. And then Mubarak was gone, and 5 weeks later elections, and everybody was not only surprised but shocked that the Muslim Brotherhood wins 47% and the more radical Salafist Union another 26%, which is altogether a two-third majority. Why were we all surprised? Because nobody went outside the center of Cairo in these 3 weeks. You could have learned already by going to the slums of Cairo or by going further into the countryside that people are much more conservative politically, religiously, culturally. And there the Muslim Brotherhood got 90% in some districts, yeah? So we all, and something similar happened with us, all of us covering what happened on the Maidan in January, February last year. Nobody went out to the east at this time, trying to sense out what do the people in the eastern parts of Ukraine think about all this. We only did it when the war started there, yeah? So I think we have huge problems, and we should devote some time of our discussion about how we get out of that, whether there is a possibility in the context of the technological realities Richard described, whether there is a possibility. My answer is yes, but I think we should discuss that later.
Okay, we definitely will come to that. Andreas was telling me last night about was it an ABC journalist or NBC journalist who'd been filming in the Vietnam War, and it took 6 or 7 days for the pictures to get back to the US. That has changed quite considerably. Max, you, what Andreas was saying there, you know, we're in Cairo, we're in Kiev, but we're not looking beyond the capitals. Is that something that you've experienced as well? You've been in Washington, you're in Brussels, Berlin. Are we too focused on these capitals?
Well, I can say for Europe and the U.S., we did go beyond the capitals, definitely. Even, I mean, in the U.S., that was probably most of what we're doing. It depends on access, you know. The question is, where do you have the most access? As a foreign correspondent, as a German foreign correspondent, for example, in the U.S., you don't really have that much access at the White House. Even the German correspondents who sit at the White House press conference every day, they don't get an interview with Obama because the politicians there, and especially the White House, says, okay, what's in it for us? So you go beyond the capital. You try to tell the stories about gun control, about or not, about abortion, and talk to the people. For that, it's a fantastic country. Here in Europe, it's a different story. In Brussels, you have a lot of access to decision makers, so you try to cover that more. And then, of course, there's the security situation also. I mean, I know all the stories, and Catherine obviously knows that a lot better than I do. In Baghdad, most of the journalists, they just sit in their hotels, and they have the stringers and the cameramen who go out, the Iraqis who go out there and do the actual work. So it's a security question as well. For Europe, I would say no, you know, we're not just in the capitals, we go out of the capitals. In the US, that was true too. But I would like to add something to what Andrea said earlier, because I had the same initial reaction to what Richard said in the beginning, and in my head it was like, yeah, sure, BBC, you can do that, you know, you can ignore things, which you don't, I think so, but a story like Charlie Hebdo, for example, or German Wings, obviously the BBC is there too. But I do agree, especially if you work for live TV these days, you have to be there fast. Because that's, for some people, especially the younger generations, that's the main reason why they're still watching TV. If you're there with a live satellite connection, then that's the moment, and something is actually happening at that moment. That's the moment where most people watch, because that's where they get the fastest reaction to what's happened, even faster maybe than Twitter or the more complete picture. That's why people still are watching live sports, for example, why that's a stronghold of TV. So I do believe as a live TV station, you have to be there. You have to try to be there quick, especially in those cases. The question is, what do you do then? Do you just describe, you know, what you're seeing, same thing over and over again, or do you really try to put it into context, paint a bigger picture? What is the source of that conflict? So I don't think it's bad to be there as fast as possible, but what you do then counts.
Of course, what Andreas, I think, is saying is that we have hardly any time to look at that context and do some research on what is actually going on in the background. Let me just have some punctuation here. Yakov Leon is telling me that we have some tweets. Can I borrow your microphone for a second, Richard? And we'll give it to Yakov. What are people tweeting into this discussion?
Well, let's start with some really good news. Global Media Forum is among top 10 most discussed topics on Twitter. In this very moment, it's at number 2 in Germany. There's a lot of interesting tweets and posts. We have read at least 1,000, I think, so far. And here are just a few. Deutsche Welle represent human rights, democracy, and rule of law. Then Global Media Forum taking place in Old Parliament Building. We all feel like lawmakers. Apparently, a lot of people on social media were quite excited because of the red button we had here in the plenary hall and because of the launch of Deutsche Welle TV channel in English. Lots of pictures. Here's one quite entertaining tweet. Another normal day in the former Bundestag, but there's a big red button. The temptation to run and push is high. Or Global Media Forum is like a rock concert, but for media types. Referring to our panel discussion, Anuranda Sharma is asking, are journalists obsessed with violence and gore? Olga also tweeted an interesting question, how to deal with propaganda, fake news in Germany, referring to Russian media. Nyeri, if it bleeds, it leads, is justified as long as the coverage is representative of reality, our role in creating solutions, question mark. Another interesting thought, What do we do with audiences who only look for the blood in the news? No viewers, no money.
Okay, thank you, Yakov. Well, let's pick up on that. The role of the audience, Richard, is that the reason that we're leading on the bleeding? Is that what the audience wants?
Not forgetting I disagreed with the question. But, okay, I just want to go back to something Andreas said, I'll respond to that. On this point of speed, actually it relates to the point about what the audience wants as well. I suppose the reason I'm more optimistic than perhaps Andreas is, or perhaps than people might think, is because I don't actually think it's either or. I mean, I do think, of course, we're all under great pressure to produce stories as quickly as we possibly can, to get pictures on air as quickly as we can, to get stories onto our digital platforms as rapidly as possible. I don't think that the reason the Vietnam story took 6 days to get to air was because we spent 6 days thinking about it. It's because the technology didn't allow it to get to air much more quickly. And of course, today...
To interrupt, but that of course meant, that's what we were discussing yesterday, that the journalists who were putting together that package had 6 days to think about it and research.
Well, that's not necessarily true, actually. If the reporter on the scene was recording his script on the location and then sending it back on a plane or a boat or what have you, he may have been doing it just as rapidly. It just took a long time to get from where he or she was to the place where the story was broadcast from. But anyway, that's a slight... it's not really directing the issue head on. I think that... The reason I'm more confident is because I think, although very strongly we can see audiences want things reported rapidly and there is competition in doing so, I don't think that is the only thing that audiences want. And that brings us back, I think, to the question you just asked, which is, of course, as news organizations, it is our job to deliver services that audiences want, but also to deliver services that audiences need. Sometimes they don't know what they want until actually you've produced it for them. And I think you can see very strong evidence that audiences will engage with journalism which goes behind the headlines, which goes further than just the pictures, just the most dramatic moment. You can absolutely see that. And the way that I would treat the relationship between those two things is that first of all, you bring people in, you attract them to what you do by making sure that your services are your news is delivered as fast as possible and in ways which are engaging and relevant and all of those sorts of things, but that you also try to take your audience beyond that. And just as an example, this morning, just before I came to this, I looked at what are the three stories that are performing the best on the BBC website this morning globally. One of them is Taylor Swift and Apple, iTunes, Spotify, or the deal they've finally reached. The other was Greece, obviously, and the third, actually, maybe slightly surprising, is a very long-form piece of journalism we've done about a place called White Horse Village in China, following the story of this village over the past 10 years as it became actually converted into a major city in Western China. And because we produce that in a certain kind of way, done very attractively, very professionally, that has engaged an audience. So you can do it. So I don't disagree that being fast and that puts a great deal of pressure on all of us as journalists, but I don't think that's the only story.
Let's stick, though, for a second with this speed that we have to employ these days as journalists. One of the key issues at this Global Medium Forum and at this Media Summit is the interplay or the interaction between foreign policy and crisis reporting. Is the pressure that we're with putting on politicians with our reporting, for instance, the refugee crisis in the Mediterranean, is that justified, that pressure on politicians, or are we asking them to be as fast as we are and produce a solution in 2:30? Annika?
I'm not sure that we are asking them to produce a solution in 2:30, but But sure, I think we are putting pressure on them, but we are not the only ones who are putting pressure on them. I mean, the human story behind them really is the pressure, in my opinion. And that's the one that should be sort of, you know, at the forefront, not what the media are telling about the story. Can I come back a little bit to speed? Because it's an interesting question, and I do think Andreas is right when he says that speed is essential, not only when it comes to competing for news, but it's also competing for venture capital for those new electronic media that are springing up, particularly in the US, because for them also being first and being able to show that they were first might be the key to get more capital to get going. But that's sort of just one part of the story, I think. I tend to belong to the optimist gang here together with Richard, because I do believe that there is room for analysis. I do believe that there are people who are interested in real analysis. And I do think that people also want other stories than the really bleeding ones. I do think there is an audience out there for that kind of reporting. Okay. I deviated a little bit from the politicians, sorry about that.
But no worries. Catherine.
I agree with you, but I think, you know, people are choosing the means of information and they have a big choice. If I want to know what's going on in a, you know, hard to reach place and something has happened and maybe the means of communication are cut and I can't really get there and this is not a place where everybody has a correspondent, you know, I would choose Twitter for information because, you know, I presume that people there tweet if they do. Like, you know, if you take the earthquake in Haiti, you know, before we even got there, I mean, telephone lines were cut, but for some reason, the mobile network still worked. And people were tweeting, and it was, you know, like from the accounts of what was happening on the ground, you know, people, you know, were telling about it. You could get information before you could even get there. And good information, because people were just describing what was happening around them. That wasn't so much about analysis, though, because, you know, it was an earthquake. But if you want analysis, I mean, I think you have to look in different places for different information, and I think people know that by now. And the discussion shouldn't be, you know, do we have to do all? If you're a reporter and you're sent to places, you're probably there in the first place to report on what's going on at that moment, you know? If you have a good knowledge of the place, perfect, you know, then you can give an analysis at the same time. But let's be fair, you know, very often we are sent to places where we don't know the background of everything and we don't know the politicians and we have no clue at what's going on in this country. And that is news reporting reality as well. Mm-hmm. So then you rely on somebody else, you know, at headquarters, at home, you know, who's, you know, collecting the analysis and has all the knowledge and you divide your jobs. So, you know, I would say there's demand for everything and, you know, and different media outlets are catering to these demands. That's my assumption, but, you know, just very quickly to come back to your question from the beginning, you know, does the news media drive foreign policy or not? I think it does and it does not. And, you know, while preparing for this discussion, I found an interesting article that was actually published in the Cambridge journals. And these guys called it the CNN effect. And the CNN effect being that, you know, if a lot of media decide to cover a conflict, then foreign policy has no choice but to react to this, you know, the foreign policy makers, in one way or another, because, you know, public opinion in the national audience as is being, you know, influenced by what is being reported on. And then they said something else in this article that was their second finding, and this is something I found very interesting, and that goes back to what you said earlier. They found something that they called, you know, manufacturing consent, and that meant basically that the media doesn't really drive the foreign policy makers, but is more or less supporting decisions or lines of foreign policy that has been made before them, because, you know, diplomats learned as well from this ever-faster going media. And this is, I think, what we see with media outlets like, you know, all these national televisions that are being broadcasted in English, such as Russia Today or Press TV from Iran, France 24, you know, all these different, you know, states that are broadcasting in English to a global audience. And I think that is, you know, a point worth discussing as well.
I like that sentence, manufacturing consent. That's an important phrase. Perhaps I can just throw that back to Richard and talk about the refugee crisis. Britain, perhaps you can give us an insight on this as someone who's based in Britain. Britain is still resisting a European solution to the refugee crisis and distributing refugees in a more equitable manner, helping Italy and Greece. How is Cameron resisting that? I mean, Britain is only one of several countries resisting that solution, but is there a different consent being manufactured in Britain on that issue?
Well, I'm not really going to answer that question, because actually I don't think it's the job of a journalist at the BBC to talk about what is, you know, the way in which British foreign policy is pursued. And actually it goes back to something I wanted to say in response to Katrin's point, which is that actually I don't think it is, it's not our job as journalists to influence foreign policy. That's not the purpose of what we do. Actually, the purpose of what we do is to increase the audience's understanding, to leave audiences better informed about the issues that affect their world. And then it's up to them to decide what they do with that information. Mm-hmm. And so it would be wrong for me to sort of explain, kind of promote British foreign policy in that context in response to your question, as much as it would be to say that the Russian government is wrong or that the Syrian government is wrong. It's not our job to do that. It's our job to report what's going on in the best way we possibly can. And that is obviously becoming harder and harder in a more and more complicated world. But you have to have, as far as I'm concerned, a line that you draw very clearly between where our job starts, which is just reporting, explaining, understanding, and where it stops, which is to have a mission to influence policy, to change policy. We don't do that.
It's not the mission, but perhaps it's the effect of our reporting.
But it may well be the effect of it, but I don't think that's quite the same point. And I think it's a really important distinction, actually. And maybe it does go back to some of the other channels that Katrin was talking about. Perhaps that is their purpose, is to promote the policy of their countries, of their governments. But that's not the policy that we pursue. And I think it's one of the reasons why people continue to have very high levels of trust in what we do, because they understand that. They can see the difference between something which is trying as hard as it possibly can to be fair and accurate and responsible and all those kinds of things. Again, things we've heard a lot about already this morning in the speeches earlier, and journalism which performs a different function. I think I'd be interested to hear what Andreas's view on this subject is, but I think that's just a basic article of faith for the BBC in how we approach things. Mm-hmm.
Well, I would agree with Richard that it's not our purpose as journalists to intentionally try to influence whether it's foreign policy or domestic policy. And it's also true that if there is a crisis like an earthquake, or if tens of thousands of people strand as refugees and some thousands are drawn in the Mediterranean, this is newsworthy. But we should be aware of the fact that by reporting on some of these issues, we do de facto create pressure on our politicians. I mean, I remember back in the Yugoslav wars, 1 year, 93, every night, pictures from enclosed Sarajevo, and the Red Cross doesn't get the food in, and people are starving. This put a lot of pressure on the governments and the Security Council of the UN to act, and pictures from people drowning in the Mediterranean or being camped somewhere in Italy also de facto create pressure. But the answer is not to say, okay, then we don't report about it because we don't want to play the role of exerting pressure. But I just want to come back to the first point, because I still would challenge the notion that we all have to do the same all the time at a certain event. And I stick to this Tahrir example. What would have happened if after 2 weeks of every night the same news, the same pictures on CNN, on Al Jazeera, on Deutsche Welle, on BBC, of showing us the Tahrir Square, one of us would have gone to a village far out in the countryside and asked all the people who you're going to vote for at the next election, and we would have found out 90% save for the Muslim Brotherhood. And this would have been our lead story this evening, and not another night pictures from the Tahrir. What would have been wrong with that? who defines really, in a context like that, in a conflict context like that, what is the actual news? I mean, I think there should be a question mark. Is it 200,000 people who are for the 14th night on the same square, or is it the question, what do other people in this country feel about it, think about it, yeah? And I think, since we are here at the launch of the Deutsche Welle English channel, maybe that would have been, or maybe still is, the chance for the Deutsche Welle English in the future not to enter this rat race with the big BBC, with CNN and Al Jazeera, to do the same news at the same time and be the first one with the best pictures, but to give us the background, the analysis, and maybe the somewhat contrasting news in a certain conflict, rather than trying to compete with a budget which has been increased a little bit, as we heard today, but it's still only a fraction of the budget the BBC has, or CNN has, or Al Jazeera has.
Let me, Annika, I'll come to you in just a second, but I would like to ask Max, should we... should DW get out of the rat race?
Like I said, I'm not sure I would call it a rat race. I think there are stories you can't ignore. And Andreas, as much as I agree with a lot of things you said, you can't ignore when hundreds of thousands of people are on that square, you know, and the people who wanted to express themselves are there. The story you said you wanted to see, I agree. I'm not even sure that story wasn't made. I think it was, but always as a what we call a B report, you know, a B piece. You have to start where it's happening.
But why then is that? Was the whole world surprised and shocked about the Egyptian election result? How is that possible? If all the world media have been in the country for 4 weeks in a row, all the big shots and all the quick teams, everybody was there, and then we have an election result and everybody is absolutely surprised and negatively shocked. Explain that to me. It was like the Berlin Wall falling.
Not to the same extent, but in Great Britain, we had a similar effect at the elections a couple of weeks ago. So this is not about Egypt or something. You know, people sometimes get it wrong. There are silent majorities. There's people who decide at the last moment. And in a country like Egypt, it's even if you go to a village and you ask those people, who are you going to vote for? That's still not representative of what the country is going to do. So it's extremely hard. There are people who get paid a lot of money to get those numbers, and they still get it wrong. So thinking that one report or two reports would change that, I don't think that's the reality of things. But I do firmly believe that you really, especially as a TV station, need to be at the place where it's happening. That's not a rat race. That's because, well, if it bleeds, it leads. Bleed doesn't necessarily have to mean that there's actual blood. It can be financial bleeding, like in the case of Greece. That's, you know, the notion of news values. We're all familiar with that. If it's something that people feel could affect their lives, then they're interested in it. If they see something boiling over like it did in the Middle East, and by the way, I talked to an Algerian friend the other day, it's unrelated, but Algeria seems like a haven of stability nowadays if you look at what's happening down there. Anyway, so if people feel that it's important for them, for their lives, it could affect them somehow, take German wings. People take planes all the time. Is this something that could happen to them? Charlie Hebdo, Newtown, Boston Marathon, all those things. Maybe it seems like a rat race because you have so many SNGs, so many reporters there, but I do believe that audiences are interested in because they want to have conclusions whether something like that could happen to them.
Can I just remind you to keep your microphones a little bit closer to your lips? I think everybody can hear properly, but it'll just help a little bit. Annika is wanting to say something, and Richard. Should we go for Annika first?
Well, I don't think it's either or. I think somebody else said it earlier. It's not either or. It can be both. And possibly the answer to your question, why were we so surprised about what happened in Egypt afterwards? Because we don't probably have enough understanding about it. It's not necessarily because we were all in the wrong place. But I think it was Katrin who said that you need a thorough understanding of where you are, really sort of in-depth understanding. And I don't remember whether the story from a village in Egypt was made. I suspect it was. But I can give you another example. One of the best sources of my information of what is happening in Ukraine today is one of my former colleagues who has an in-depth understanding of not only what's happening in Ukraine, but also what is happening in Russia, and who insists on traveling to all kinds of places, remote places, constantly, and giving in-depth information about that. And I suspect, because I'm an optimist, that I'm not the only person who values her reports from there, because they help me understand, and everybody else as well, and possibly also the foreign policy makers are helped by these kind of reports, I think.
Richard.
Going back to just trying to draw some of these things together, I don't actually think the British election and the Egyptian point are the same points. In a way, the British election thing was very much a sort of, you know, a technical thing about the way in which polling worked during the election campaign. Really, the point you're making is that are we as journalists doing our job as well as we should do by only looking at the headline issue and not going into the issues that lie below that, so that we end up being surprised by the way events turn out? I absolutely don't think that's the case. I think that if I can look back at how we covered the Egyptian story, and I look at how we've been covering the Ukrainian story in recent times, I don't think that's the case. But I think the issue that arises, and where I think your point is valid, is that, and this is particularly true, I think, for television more than perhaps for radio and even for digital services, is that obviously the picture dominates. And so you take a story like Egypt, and the dominant image is of the thousands of people in the square protesting, and that's let me just finish the point.
The result could be that you don't get the representative right picture of the situation in the whole country.
What I'm trying to come to with that point is that to say that if that's the image that you're the only image that you can remember, then that's a problem for us as journalists. But I'm not quite sure what it is that we do differently, other than if we know that the thing that draws the audience in is the image from the square. That's what's happening at the moment. Further down the news bulletin, we take the time to go and discuss some of the other issues, to discuss what's happening in other parts of Egypt. We did that. We do that sort of thing all the time. We do that further down. I'm not sure what it is that we're not doing. Are you suggesting that we should reverse that and say that actually the live image is going to come, you know, at 9:15, but we're going to start with the village in Egypt? I just don't know if that works, if that is a way that audiences would respond to. I think the really key question, though, is are we doing that in our journalism? And if we're failing to do that, then we should be held to account for doing so. But I do think we're trying really hard to do that sort of thing.
Let me just interject here, because I think we're really at the core of this debate right now. Is the dominance of spectacular pictures, the if it bleeds, it leads maxim, is that getting in the way of background journalism, in the way of research? Should we be doing more? Should we as journalists be looking more at solutions, looking more at the positive aspects of things? We focus on the divisive, we focus on the violent, we focus on conflict. Do we not focus enough on the solutions to those conflicts? Max.
I had a friend in France once who worked for a journal called Journal des Bonnes Nouvelles, which was familiar with that. I think it doesn't exist anymore. So, and they were strictly ratings. The thing is, and again, news values. It's been proven that people respond more or are more interested in negative stories than positive stories. You know, that's why it's called news, because things change from the better to the worse. That doesn't mean you can't report on positive things. Not at all. But normally when things are going well, or even if they're going bad, but if they're constant, they just tend to be forgotten, for example, or they tend not to be reported. That's what Catherine said earlier. If you have a conflict,
who's forgetting them? Is it the people or the journalists?
I think it's a question of resources also, but it's also a question of, you know, when something changes, then it's there. Take, for example, the conflict between the Palestinians and Israel at the moment. It's, at least as far as I can tell, it's rather on the back burner at the moment. The problems are still there. They're getting worse. It's fading behind other conflicts, but behind Daesh, Islamic State, here in Europe, it's fading behind Greece. But that doesn't mean it's not there anymore. And maybe in that context, about pictures, you asked, do we always have to show, you know, the big pictures and where something is actually just the sensational pictures. Well, normally, if you have sensational pictures, it is a good indication for that something important is happening.
I'm not saying we shouldn't show them. I'm saying, are they getting in the way of the background, of context?
One doesn't exclude the other. Like Richard said, you know, you will start off with the stuff that draws people in, and then you have the chance to actually go and give a little background, go in depth. I think it's problematic, though, when you, for example, the conflict, Palestinians-Israel. What you have there, because it's been going on for such a long time, is people are so aware of the media that's there that they go in front of the camera. Each time you have a camera, you have a couple of people, and they see the camera, and then you have the wailing, and you have sort of some sort of public acting. I'm not saying all of it is that way, but you do. You know, people try to use the media also for their means. So as a journalist in these situations, I think you have to make sure that you're not showing something that's a reaction of people to the camera, but that's actually genuine and is a symbol of what's happening, of an important event.
But I think, you know, journalism can't be about solutions. I mean, that is too much to ask from a journalist. I couldn't give you a solution to the, well, if I stay with your example, Israeli-Palestine conflict. And, you know, a lot of policymakers, journalists, I don't know, but a lot of people tried. Certainly, that's not what I'm, you know, in the news for. As Richard said earlier, you know, you're trying to explain as best as you can to your local audience or to your national audience what the conflict you're reporting on is all about. In the best, you know, if things are in an ideal world, I would say, then people form their own opinion, and then this opinion could have an influence, maybe, you know, on what foreign policy makers do. Is that the case? When it comes to conflicts, I think very often not. You know, very often you know, journalists fail to make people understand what's going on. And I think if we stay in the Mideast, a lot of people just say, this is too complicated, we don't understand that anymore. And like for years and years and years, all these media outlets we are talking about made the effort of explaining it to their audiences. Still, obviously, we failed. So that is something to think about. I don't quite know if your approach works. Well, you know what you were saying when you gave the example of Tahrir Square and like somebody going to, you know, more rural Egypt and listen to public opinion there. I don't want to go into all this discussion about the square and the rural Egypt again, but I think there's a tiny little thing. I think, you know, a lot of people weren't so surprised that the Muslim Brotherhood won the elections, but that's a different discussion maybe. So I think, you know, I don't quite know what the solution is. If I want to be positive, I would argue that the fact that we have so many different media outlets and that even, you know, citizen journalists that are, you know, not being looked upon, you know, by a lot of people with great enthusiasm, it gives you options. And there has never been so many options to get your information as today. You just need to know how to use them properly. And then there's a chance of being extremely well informed in the 21st century.
Andreas. Andreas has been waiting.
Well, I challenge some of the answers. I do not think that it's our task to suggest solutions. And I do not think that we should do what is sometimes being called peace journalism. But I think we should do what is called conflict-sensitive journalism. And this means that we as journalists do not, from the outset and through the whole period of a conflict, accept the framework that is being set by the main actors. Give you a concrete example. Yugoslavia wars start in 91, 92, Bosnia, Croatia, Slovenia. The European Union, United Nations have a joint peace conference in Geneva trying to end the conflict and find some political solution. Who is being invited to this conference? The presidents of the republics, Mr. Milosevic from Belgrade, Mr. Tudjman from Zagreb, Mr. Izetbegovic from Sarajevo, and the warlords in the fields, Ratko Mladic, Karadzic, you remember all the names. And they have been accepted by us journalists as the representatives of all these ethnic groups living there for 3 years in a row. One morning, I come with my bicycle to the UN, four young men, very dirty and didn't get much sleep, tried to get into the UN. I said, can I help you? They turned out to be Croats from Croatia who traveled all the way on their own expenses from Zagreb to Geneva to make the point to the world that Mr. Tuchman, who was sitting there on the negotiation table for 3 years, does not at all represent all the Croats in Croatia and in Bosnia and Herzegovina, and that there are many Croats who want to live in peace with the Muslims and Serbs. So I probably overstepped my role as a journalist by helping those four men with my press card to get into the UN, hold a press conference there, which changed the picture completely. The chief negotiators, David Owen from Britain and Cyrus Vance from the US, had to invite other representatives from the Croats, from the Muslims, from the Serbs to the table, and not only have it limited to the nationalist leaders. So I would use the phrase, now I use German, not unparteilich and not überparteilich, but allparteilich, which means to make sure as a reporter that all people, all sides affected of a conflict are being heard and are being listened to. And not only those who happen to be the leaders of the conflict, the nationalist ones who get maybe some kind of profit out of it. This, I think, is our role. And since one other example, what happened, I did a scientific research about the German print media on the Ukraine. I don't know about the British or the Spanish or whatever, the Germans. And I found out those two problematic groups in the opposition, Svoboda and the right-wing sector, were not mentioned in any German print publication, with one exception, before January last year, before they played a visible role on the Maidan with all their guns. Which means we have neglected the very, all the other media presented a picture that all the opposition in Ukraine are democratic, Europe-orientated people who want to get in the EU, and this other part of the opposition did not exist, with one exception, one journalist who lives in Moscow, who travels to Ukraine and gave us this picture. Yeah? So I think there are a lot of these examples, and the problem started much earlier when many media outlets decided to withdraw their correspondents. CNN executive board on the nights of September 10th, 2001, came together in Atlanta. They had a world map and they decided these areas, large parts of Asia, Soviet Union, are not interesting anymore. We withdraw our correspondents. The colleagues in the Berlin office and CNN got their letter of being fired the night to September 11th. 8 hours later, the world changed dramatically. But the result is we still have places in the world where they're totally understaffed by foreign correspondents, and if there is somebody, he or she has only the resources to stay in the capital and not travel the country. And this is true for many ARD stations. Maybe BBC is in a better position. But this was his starting point, back 3 years ago when things started in Egypt and in Tunisia, we were not in a very good position to really know what's really happening in the country, and the same in Ukraine.
Yes, I just want to say the word you were looking for, I think, was impartial, and I just wanted to just make one little correction. I'm not suggesting we as journalists should provide solutions, but we might think more about focusing on people who are trying to provide solutions, focusing on the search for solutions. Richard.
I just want to say, I think we're talking about two slightly different issues here, actually. I mean, what Andreas has just said, I completely agree with everything he's just said there. It reminds me of a colleague that I work with at the BBC who once said to me, when the news pack goes into action and everybody turns left, I turn right. And actually, a tradition in journalism of people who actually do ask awkward questions, who don't just follow the pack, who do try and understand things a little differently. And absolutely, there is a role for that. There must be room for that. It doesn't mean that, again, going back to the Tahrir Square example, that we don't report what's going on in the square, but we also do other things. And I think, in a way, that's what Andreas is trying to capture, that if journalism is doing its job well, it's doing the kinds of things that he's saying, I would argue, as well as the other things. But I think the second point we're discussing, in a way, it goes back to the question. You said we were getting to the core of the question. In a way, you could have asked this question, if it bleeds, it leads, at any point in the history of modern journalism, in particular since television journalism came along. So what's different now? And obviously the thing that's different now is digital, is the fact that stories are shared and spread faster than we possibly could have imagined a few years ago, and that everybody is able to publish their own journalism. And really that's the core of the question for me, is what do we do in response to that? What is our job in that world? How do we make sure that we as a mainstream traditional news organization, as people would see it, remain relevant to the audiences that are seeking that kind of journalism? That's the real challenge for us, and that's the sort of thing that keeps me lying awake at night. How do we make sure that our journalistic values remain relevant in that world? And that's what I think is the real question here.
That's coming back to the speed issue. Let me just interrupt just for a second here. Andreas mentioned peace journalism, conflict-sensitive journalism. There is also a relatively new development called constructive journalism, which is in the, many of the Scandinavian countries. And we're very lucky to have had a film produced for us by Ulrik Hagerup. Ulrik Hagerup is the head of Danish radio and TV, and one of the main proponents of constructive journalism. And I'd ask our Régie to play that film for us.
Hi, and thank you for letting me talk to you about something rare in journalism conferences these days. I want to talk to you about content, on why we are here, about the role of journalism, of how we can be meaningful again in the eyes of an audience which is turning its back to traditional news media these days. Not only because the change of news habits and change of technology, but because they do not trust us to give them the full picture of the world. Because they're fed up with the negativity we sell them in news with a label that we call, this is the news, this is the world, but is it? A good story doesn't have to be a bad story, as me and my colleagues have been educated for the last 30 years. And we learned already on the first day at journalism school that a good story is a bad story. And we quoted the former editor of the Times saying, before interviewing any politician, ask yourself, why is this bastard lying to me? At DR, we try to remember that our job is to throw light, not to spread darkness and unnecessary fear. That's what the constructive news is all about. To help us remember that our job is to see the world with both eyes. Not only the journalistic eye, which only focus on the things that do not work, all the problems, all the conflicts, all the wars, all the crooks, but that we report both on the problems, ask critical questions, and do stories that inspire, look for ways out, and thereby enhance the quality of the public debate. Media struggling for a future have to understand that we probably will get the same results that we have always gotten if we go on doing what we have always done. So if we're not satisfied with the current situation where people in the millions are turning away from traditional newspapers and broadcast, here's a good idea. Change. Constructive news, which is now in its third circulation in English and published in German this week, is a firing squad aiming at the bad habits in news journalism. But it's also a handbook on how to, in our daily work, benefit to the societies and democracies we actually are here to serve. This is Constructive News. Thank you for listening. Have a great conference.
Perhaps we should, at this point, we have about half an hour to go before lunch, bring in the audience. And I see there's a gentleman over there who already wants, there are lots of people who want to ask questions. Since that gentleman was first, could I just ask you, when you get a microphone brought to you, which I think is happening as we speak, do we have microphones on the way? Yes, coming down there. If you could stand up, just give us your name, where you're from, and perhaps who you work for.
My name is Fethi, and I'm from Egypt, and I fully support what Richard say. I think the problem of if it bleeds, it leads, it's not about our readers. It's about our newsrooms and how these newsrooms were built and how our journalists were educated. I'm managing one of the news media organizations in Egypt. And I think it's very easy to come to an answer. Let's evaluate what we are doing as journalists now. The whole business is declining. We cannot attract more readers. We are losing our readers in print, and we cannot find our ways in digital until now. I think if we evaluate what are the most read, the most emailed, the most shared stories, we will understand that if it bleeds, it leads, is not working anymore. Readers are looking for something different. And I think the need from us to open for them opportunities. And regarding Egypt, I just want to comment about, I think the foreign journalists in Cairo, they are just following what the Egyptian journalists are doing. It's all about Cairo media. No one lives outside, no one understands the society outside. That's why, yes, we were shocked, and we didn't imagine that the whole society will vote in this way, because we are just focusing on Cairo, because Cairo, where they will find what it bleeds, it leads. I thank you for your contributions, and I think what bleeds, it leads is a part of the old media, and it doesn't work anymore now. Go and see what readers are reading now. You will not find that. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. The gentleman in the white shirt over there.
Thank you very much. My name is Rida Falboum. I'm a Libyan journalist, a freelancer. I used to be a TV anchor, but I stopped because of the conflict and the war. My question is for the BBC and the international media as well. Libya was a focus on the media coverage every day by BBC and other international media, focusing on the conflict during 2011, about everyday reports. But after the killing of Gaddafi and toppling the Gaddafi regime, we have not seen, it's been quiet. Libya now is a shattered country, and it's people are suffering. We have not seen if it bleeds, it leads. Nothing coming out of Libya. So my question is, why is this happening? We have more than 4,000 people displaced. People are suffering. Electricity cut off every day. Some places people can't get even bread, and the international media not covering what's going on in Libya. The media played a big role. What's the role of international media to bring back the stability and to the shattered country? Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Richard.
Thank you for your question. I'm just not sure I really recognize that picture you paint, to be honest. I think the BBC has been covering what's been happening in Libya all the way through this period in which the country has become completely fractured. If you just go into a search on the BBC News website now, you'll find, I think, any number of stories that continue to report that. I think the issue, of course, is whether it gets the prominence, whether it gets the same level of attention. And, of course, it is a reality of the way the media works, not just the BBC, all news organisations, and particular in the period of news that we're in at the moment, where there is so much that's happening in so many different places, we move on and we cover other things. But I don't think that has been completely to the exclusion of what's going on in Libya. I think it's just the fact of life that with so many other things to report as well, it hasn't had as much attention. Also, it's actually quite a difficult country to report from. We heard earlier about sometimes how difficult it is to get to the places you want to get to, about the issues to do with security and the way in which you can work. It's not easy to do that. But I do think just one recent example, the migrant story that we've all been doing in such in great length and depth in recent weeks, a lot of that goes back to Libya. That's where a lot of the migrants are starting out from. We've reported that. We've worked quite hard at covering that end of the story. So I do think we're doing it, but I take your point that giving it the same level of prominence that it had going back 4 years is a more difficult issue for us.
Right, we had an African gentleman, and while the microphone is getting to him, Yakov, Leon, give us a quick idea of what's happening on Twitter. I'm going to borrow your microphone again. We'll be with you in just a second.
Well, it's definitely quite alive on Twitter. A lot of people using hashtag DW underscore GMF and sharing thoughts and asking questions. In the meantime, GMF is the most discussed topic on Twitter in Germany. Great news. Here are a few interesting tweets. Marie Le Mensch tweeted, some conflicts are underreported and are also not in the minds of policymakers, like South Sudan, Central African Republic, Darfur, because that's a problem. One of the questions for our speakers is how to deal with CNN or Fox News, who are often looking for scandal. Norman Schreppel is having a dilemma. Is it possible to have quality news coverage, but also fast and exclusive news? Raisa Robias is asking, who is actually forgetting the long drawn conflicts, the journalists or the people? Oliver Push, how do these traditional media sitting on your panel see the competition coming from online only players like Vice News? Katy Burton, does media drive foreign policy? Do governments respond to viewers? CNN, in fact, question mark. Diplomats influence media and the reverse. And a message to Andreas Zumach, people are complaining that they cannot find you on Twitter.
People are complaining they can't find you on Twitter, Andreas. That you're not on Twitter. They're looking for your Twitter handle.
I don't have a Twitter follow yet, and I don't intend to.
What I can recommend, if you speak German, is buy his newspaper, Die Tageszeitung, and of course they're online as well. Do you have English language pages on at the Taz?
Sorry?
Do you have English language pages at Die Tageszeitung?
No, we don't have, unfortunately, yet.
Not yet.
Not yet.
The gentleman who has the microphone, thank you for being patient. Where are you from?
Okay, thank you very much. My name is Efe Atio. I'm a Nigerian currently working and living in Tanzania. Over the years, Africans have felt very misrepresented and misreported by the international media. I mean, even if you go to journalism school, that's one of the first things that you're told. You're also told that if a man bites a dog, if a dog bites a man, it's no news. But when the man bites the dog, that's when it becomes news. But it appears to me, the technology is changing, the way news moves is changing, but the media itself is not changing. We are refusing to change, we're refusing to move with the times, and so we're just holding onto relics of the way media has appeared to be over time. Also, I guess there's the question of objectivity versus profitability. What exactly informs the choice of the story? Is it that we want to be objective? What's the aim of the international reportage? Is it because we really want to tell that story, or is it because we just want people to keep subscribing to our network? Two people die in a bomb blast in somewhere in Nigeria, and it's big news. And yet people are dying every day. Hundreds of people are dying every day. So how do we make a choice, and how do we decide on what needs to be reported?
Okay.
I'd like to respond. I very much agree with your analysis in your first sentence that Africa is probably the by far most underrepresented, undercovered part of the world in the media. You can only change that by making an intentional decision to change it. The little paper I'm working for, the Tageszeitung Berlin, made this decision 10 years ago. We have approximately 50%, sometimes even more, of our whole foreign reporting devoted to the continent of Africa. We have a lot of correspondents there, not all fully employed because we don't have the money, but stringers, etc., more than any other print media and any other electronic media in Germany. But this is an intentional decision. Your colleagues who cover Asia, who cover the United Nations, who cover North America, have to agree to, because they get much less space. I would dream that Deutsche Welle, with the limited resources it does have compared to the other big players, maybe makes a similar conscious decision to devote much more coverage to the African continent than, let's say, to Washington or all the other familiar places.
Max Hofmann.
I'm not the expert on our Africa program because I'm in Brussels, but I know that we have made exactly that decision with the arrival of our new general manager, Peter Limburg, and we do have a studio now in Nigeria, by the way. We have producers, stringers, we work with a lot of video journalists because we have come obviously to the same conclusion, and for a news channel that is broadcast in Africa and that has a lot of success, actually, by many standards in Africa, it was a necessity to do that, so we did.
Yes, and we've just also signed up Edith Kamani, who's our new correspondent in Nairobi, in Kenya. She, by the way, Andreas, has 130,000 followers on Twitter. Annika, you wanted to say something.
That will happen after this conference, I'm sure.
If you're happy,
yeah. I'm glad you brought in Ulrich Hagerup, because he's much better at explaining what constructive news is than I am. Otherwise, I would have brought it in. But it's really about tackling those things that we've been saying. We are not the ones who should bring the solutions, but what we can do is make an extra effort and go and find those who have found the solutions and talk about those. So one of the things I would say to the comment about Africa is that Swedish television, for instance, has done an excellent series of reportage, news stories from Africa, with the exact intention of using constructive news. So they have been looking at places where people have come with solutions. So there are efforts in the world where people are trying to remedy what you are saying, because otherwise you're partly right. We're also trying to do that in the EBU. So we are at the moment we are actually looking at possibilities of increasing our coverage of Africa, and this is at the demand of our members, who want more stories from Africa, whether they are conflict-oriented or constructive or whatever, but more information.
I know that Max wants to say something.
I'm sorry, if I just may put a question to the gentleman who asked that question. I don't know if you still have the microphone up there, but do you have the impression, point taken, still underrepresented, but do you have the impression that, let's say, in the last 5 or 6 years, it's gotten better?
Okay, it has gotten better, but the question is, what exactly is getting better? Like she rightly pointed out, a journalist comes from outside and is reporting about Africa, but doesn't really understand the people, because there are a lot of decisions that are taken by people in Africa and other parts of the world also that are based on the sensibilities and the culture of the people. Now, you might not understand it, so you're reporting it from a Western perspective. So you really can't understand exactly what it talks about, okay? I know that some of the media are making an effort to actually get Africans to report Africa, and I think that's a smart way to go about it.
Okay, I know that Richard also wants to say something, and then we'll be going right to the back there. We've had three gentlemen so far, so we should have a woman.
Actually, I was going to say something which is very similar to what you've just said, but I do think there's progress in this area. I think one of the biggest dangers that we can allow ourselves to slip into is of describing Africa as one place. It's 54 countries and it's complicated like everything else we've been discussing today. The policy that we pursue is to have people who are from the countries that we're reporting to, and I think that's successful for us. But equally, you can't disagree with the perception that Africa has been misreported, and that is something we pay very serious attention to, and I hope that over time people will begin to shift that impression. I would say one of the specific issues with Africa, when you look at what's happening in with the speed of digital development in the rest of the world, is actually access to audiences is still more complicated. So we have some of our largest audiences in Africa on shortwave radio. Now, our sense is, and I think the evidence is there to support that the future for African news media is basically digital and it's basically mobile. I mean, that you could perhaps say that about the rest of the world as well, but specifically for the African continent. So I think it's partly about attitudes, partly about recognizing audience perceptions and recognizing what stories you need to cover. It's partly about the technology you deploy to get to the audiences you're trying to reach.
Richard, thank you for that. Please.
My name is Bushra Jamil, and I'm from Iraq, from Baghdad. My question to Ms. Catherine about reporting from Iraq. I understand totally it's all about economy, and if it bleeds, then it leads. That's okay. But why in Iraq now, when everyone is bleeding, you mainly report on Daesh? I'm not talking about you, Ms. Catherine, only, but I'm talking about reporting from Iraq. It's mainly on Daesh. Everybody bleeds now in Iraq. Christians, Yazidis, Sunnis, everybody. And the mostly the secular elite part of the society, they bleed all the time. I started my community radio station in 2005 for women. And because I refused this philosophy, if it bleeds, then it leads. I'm very poor now, but the radio is still there and I'm still following the same policy. So I understand. But my question is why we report only on one section that bleeds, not on all section? Is it the government or is it the organization you belong to or it's what sells in the market? Thank you.
Well, unfortunately, you know, I think this is exactly the point, and thank you for the question, where you can say if it bleeds, it leads, is still accurate. When it comes to the coverage of Iraq, probably as well, there was a gentleman before from Libya, I think. When it comes to Libya as well, I could give you examples of stories I or other people did that had nothing to do with Daesh, and there was actually not even about politics in Iraq, but maybe the culture or other different subjects. But, you know, this is like a minimal amount of the coverage that Iraq gets. Why is it? Because I think at the end of the day, what we all have to understand that news, at least in my view, is always made for an audience. Now, what is the biggest interest of the audience in one particular country? That is what gets most of the coverage. When it comes to Daesh, I think, you know, it's not good, and I'm not saying it's right, but that's just how it is. This is a threat that is in Europe, or particularly in Germany and in other European countries, perceived as something that could become, you know, potentially very dangerous for our own countries. So they focus on it, on the coverage. Whereas what is happening elsewhere in Baghdad, you know, might not be so much of interest for the Germans or for the British or for the French. It's sad, probably it's bad, but that's the way it is. I mean, that's the most honest answer I could give you, but maybe we should put this question to you, Richard, because, you know, it's you know, at the end of the day, mostly it's an editorial decision what gets coverage and what doesn't.
I think it's the same, in a way, as the point about Libya, actually, which is that I think at any given point there is something which tends to be the primary focus of the news media organisations, and it then becomes harder for other things to make it into the agenda at that point. I keep coming back to this. I said right at the start, this is not either or, though. You know, our job is both and. We have to do exactly what was requested in the question, which is to cover the other stories that are taking place in Iraq, the other things that are happening to different communities, as well as making sure that we're covering what appears to be the sort of primary issue at any given point in time. But in the end, if you're thinking in the context of, say, a 25-minute news bulletin on the nightly news, you know, that's a very limited amount of space to cover things. If the context is what could the BBC do in the full breadth of its news website or its news app, then actually it becomes easier to do that. But even then, that doesn't really address the question, which is that if the largest single audience is coming to that shorter news bulletin, you have to find ways of making sure you address these kinds of issues. The way we tend to do it, one of the techniques that we use, and I don't think it would completely satisfy the question, but one of the techniques we use is that we have a particular policy of going back to stories that we haven't covered for a while, of making sure that after a period of time, we will go back to a story that we were covering. Yeah, absolutely, we do that. But I mean, that might be one feature in the course of, say, the 10 o'clock news on BBC One. I'm not suggesting it fully answers the question, but I think it's a recognition that we're trying to do the right thing.
But Richard, this is really the crucial question. Who is defining what is newsworthy? The suspicion and the question was, is it the government, the Iraqi government or the German, which let's say is nonsense. Who defines that in Libya it was only newsworthy in the short civil war to the run-up till Gaddafi was toppled and killed? Why don't we say what's happening in this country right now in Libya is at least as newsworthy and important and also threatening to us, by the way, than the time before Gaddafi was killed? Isn't it true that the most newsworthy issue should be the millions of people in the whole area from Morocco to Pakistan who live and grow up in the most precarious situation without any positive perspective for their life, which is a breeding ground for the next generation of DISH or ES or whatever the name will be? Isn't that at least as newsworthy at the time when we are partially led by our governments who are involved in a war there and we follow them? This is my question. Who defines what is newsworthy?
Okay, so of course what you say is true, that those are very big, real issues, but we are covering them. I think the question it comes back to is, if it's as simple as, is it the lead story? Well, it's not always the lead story, is it?
Well, okay, it's in the leading role of defining what's the lead story in the world.
Okay, so that's another really important point, slightly different point, I would say. But I think we are, one of the realities of the media era we are in now is that there isn't really any single definition of what is the news agenda, whose news agenda. The audience can decide themselves what the news agenda is. The audience can decide themselves who they want to get their information from. And in many parts of the world, they have more choices of free media than they've ever had before. That's not the case everywhere, but there are many places where that's the case, and they are exercising those choices. And so traditional, long-standing organizations like ours are no longer the only sources of information for those people. We make judgments about stories we cover. We do that all the time. That's what we as professional journalists consider to be part of our job. I think we're doing that with the right motivation. I think we're doing that for the right reasons. And I think if the audience trusts that, if they respect that, then they will continue to come to us. And if they don't, then they will go somewhere else. That's the reality of it.
Can I just come in and say, I don't know why we continue sort of discussing this as if there wasn't anybody doing something about it. Because the example we saw from Ulrik Kagerup, for instance, is trying to do something about it. And Denmark is a small country, DR is not the BBC, does not have the resources of the BBC. It's a small outlet after all. And they have had fantastic results with doing this. And mind you, constructive news is not telling just a positive story. It is actually trying to go one step ahead and do something and show the solutions. And maybe it's a small one. So, there are solutions. There are people who are trying to change what we are now talking about.
Perhaps I can just add at this point, you may remember in January this year, Arianna Huffington sent an email to all of her staff. They have a new, relatively new column, which is called What's Working? And in that email, Arianna Huffington said, we want to show that the era of if it bleeds, it leads is over. By relentlessly telling the stories of people and communities doing amazing things, for instance, in Iraq. These are the stories our readers are most interested in reading and sharing. You're saying that people would go somewhere else. Are the established media losing audience? And I'm talking about newspapers, I'm talking about the evening news. My son will walk out the room when the evening news comes up. Are we losing audience, that kind of audience, the audience of the future, because we are only covering doom and disaster? Max, perhaps you could start on that.
I don't think so. By the way, I still say we don't only cover doom and disaster. I'd like to maintain that. The complaints of the newspapers that they're losing people because they don't print as many newspapers anymore, I don't think that means that the audience necessarily disagrees with what the newspaper prints. I just think it's not up to date how people read their newspapers anymore. If you have a convincing way of getting your traditional stories, maybe you tweak them, they might be shorter, they might be interactive, but the core of the thing, I think, is still the same. If it's a good and important story, if it's well researched, the journalist knows what he's talking about, and if you put it in a modern form,
digitalized on a smartphone, you know, if it's right there, you use social media, then it's just as relevant as it was. The point is, though, that it's harder today because there's just so much competition out there, not only in traditional news media, but also in comedy shows, for example. A lot of the young people in the States get their news from Jon Stewart. A lot of people, young people in Germany are starting to get their news from Jan Böhmermann and other comedians. So,
but isn't that an argument for trying out things like what's being tried out in Denmark?
I think it's an argument. First of all, you got to be up to speed with how people get their news nowadays. So, you know, just saying, oh, they're not reading the print edition anymore, that's just not going to help. And the second thing is, I think there needs to be an entertaining factor more than there was in the past, obviously. I mean, if a majority of Americans get their news by people like Jon Stewart, it's because they feel entertained and they're bored by very bone dry news. I think it might be a different situation in Germany, but you have to take that into account, you know. Having said that, the core, the story, the trust, all that is still relevant. Mm.
Richard, when are the BBC going to start implementing constructive journalism?
Well, always constructive. My point about relevance is really one of the risk we face is of being irrelevant to the audience, and so the way in which we respond to that is the most important thing. And it's not that we have become irrelevant, because in fact, if you look at the audience numbers, we're reaching more people around the world than we ever have done. And I think news more generally is meeting more people than it ever has done. So I don't think that the question is whether there's a lack of demand for news, and there isn't much of a question about whether there's a lack of competition. There's an awful lot of competition out there. I think it's the organizations that will remain will be the ones that remain most relevant to their audiences, that provide value to their audiences, whether that's on a television news bulletin or on an app or within social media, whatever it is, it's whether we remain relevant. And it's up to us to recognize that and then to do the best that we can, and audiences will judge us. And that's the world that we live in now. I'm actually quite confident that we have a way of reaching audiences which does remain relevant. But I think the big challenge, and it's my last word on the subject, is that how we convert audiences who, at the moment, in large numbers, only just dip into the story. So they come for the headline and then they go away. And they don't go away with real understanding or knowledge or understanding the arguments. And how we convert those audiences to those that stay longer, understand things better. That's the or how do we convey what we do in a briefer form that people can appreciate? Those are the real challenges we face at the moment.
Okay, thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to wrap up at this on that note. I apologize for not taking more of your questions, but the good news is that all of these people, except perhaps Max, who has to rush back off to Brussels to cover the Greece crisis, are around outside in the foyer, and I'm sure they won't mind being approached by you with further questions. Most of them, Katrin says, are on Twitter, so you can address them. Thank you very much for your attention. I'm going to hand over back now to Brian Thomas, who will just give you a few important bits of information
right.
Before
Thanks
you
break Thanks so much, up. Christopher. A couple great questions coming up there. Very much. Thanks very much to our panel. How to convert customers, how to survive in the digital age, especially for traditional media. It's lunchtime. It's been an action-packed morning. You've been a great audience. Many thanks to our guest speakers, our special speakers here today, and to all of you for being here. A short bit of information, if you can turn in your headsets, that would be fantastic. And the plenary session resumes at 2:00. We're going to pick up on some of the issues here, reporting on frozen conflicts and reporting from conflict zones. That's with Daniel Gerlach from Zanet Magazine. So please be sure to join us for that. Many thanks for being a great audience. Have a fantastic lunch. See you back here at 2:00.